Joining me on the line from Cape Town is a former Springbok coach, Peter de Villiers. Peter, thank you for speaking to us here on Game On. It's such an honor to have you here. I interviewed you a few times when you were Springbok coach, and we certainly miss you in the game. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thanks, Marine, and thanks for the somebody in this country who's still missing me.
You certainly changed the way that we play rugby in South Africa, and we miss this. Do you think you're going to be holding that rugby ball soon, maybe in the next couple of months or so, taking up a team?
Well, I don't know. I really don't know what's in the future for me. But what I do know is that I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. So, yeah, it might just happen like that or something else. But I'm ready for anything.
Do you feel that things are still not sorted out between... Or how is your relationship between you and Oregon Hoskins? Do you think that they'll be able to give you an opportunity again?
No, I don't think so. What I heard is that he said to people, I will never coach again in South Africa while he is the president. So, I don't think I will be part of it when he's there. But then again, people don't have any control over my life. Mm-hmm. The only authority over my life comes from above.
Coach Heineke Meyer, from what we're seeing from the outside, does not necessarily have one game plan. And when one doesn't work, he doesn't seem to have a full plan B. And he seems to be allowed to do whatever he wants. Do you ever feel that in your time as coach, you were seem to be performance managed in some way? You couldn't have the game plan that you wanted?
No. You play what you want to play. Mm. What I understood, we have systems in this country that's actually detrimental to our outcome when we play international rugby. Our schooling system, everybody plays the same kind of bang, bang, bang. The stronger guys and the bigger guys will get a run before the more skillful guys. Then you inherit those kind of players. What I saw in my tenure too is I couldn't change to what I wanted them to do. I wanted them to read the situation, play it to the best of their abilities, but they couldn't, you know. What the players saw in front of them, there was a wall, and they wanted to break the wall down. So if I wanted to change them, then there would be a lot of confusion. So I had to change only for the sake of controlling the scoreboard. The reason why I wanted to control the scoreboard is because everybody in this game never gave us a chance. They said black people aren't good enough. Mm. And if we didn't control the scoreboard, for the rest of our lives, we would have been labeled as not good enough coaches in this country. So I had to change just to control the scoreboard a bit.
Coach, things haven't changed too much, have they? In terms of that, black players and black coaches?
Yeah, I don't think it has changed too much. There's a few logic reasons for that. One that jumps to mind is our icon, Mr. Mandela, forgave people who never asked forgiveness and never repented, you know. So the one thing that block us at the moment is that most of our people in control, they feel guilty about the past. Mm. But they can't forgive themselves, they can't love themselves. And because they can't love themselves, they can't love anybody else around them. Mm. And we all know that love overcomes fear. And at this moment, there is fear that doesn't exist, that control our whole country, control everything around us. And we're afraid to give up what is dear to us because we're so afraid we're going to lose it. By giving it up means that you can progress to the next level, and we have blocked ourselves to go to the next level.
Coach, I'm sure you've always been a fan of rugby and a supporter of Springbok Rugby, and they take on Wales in their Rugby World Cup encounter. It's a very, very important part of the Rugby World Cup, the quarterfinals. I can only presume that the mental side of the game just changes completely from pool to quarterfinals.
Yeah, definitely. Everything has changed now. We're not playing those minnows anymore. We the hope that we had to take those small teams off the field after 60 minutes is gone now. Both teams are equally strong. They do have the individuals who can be game breakers for you. And yeah, the game changes a bit to taking your opportunities, making smart decisions. And be alert at all times.
Coach, Wales will be very comfortable in those conditions. They'll be playing that running rugby, not the kind of physical game that we used to. Do you find that maybe our game has become, you know, opponents have now realized what our game plan is? We've not evolved as a rugby playing nation.
Magrin, you know, it's not only that. That is true too, but it's not only that. The professional game took everybody to the gym. So physical, everybody is at the same level. You could see the small teams, although they don't have the great game breakers, physically they could live up to what the big teams will offer them. And so the bigger teams too, all of them became so big. The edge that we had when we were only big and the other guys were smaller than us, it's gone. So you need to add something else to the game. And I think that is where we are still lacking at this moment. Mm. There's something else that we had to add to the game. But the one thing that we do have, and that's the only thing that's in our favor, is Fourie de Pre. Mm. He's such a great intellectual of the game. Oh, yeah. He's a brilliant decision maker, and he understands how to let other people play and run into spaces. So his spatial awareness is something the game is going to miss when he retires.
Well, absolutely. Is that sort of what you talk about now? Is that something that you try to bring into the game?
Definitely. You understand that talent is not enough to make you a world beater. You know, you go for the potential of the player and you try to fulfill that potential in the player. But the second thing that coaches need to understand, that rugby isn't a sport anymore. Rugby has become a lifestyle. Mm. And if you coach somebody outside what he's used to in his life every day, it's a new thing for him too. So you just need him to use those kind of God-gifted outstanding contributions that he can bring to the game and use it then as a mechanism to make other people play off him. And you only carry the ball so that you can put somebody else in a better position. At this moment, we're not doing that. We carry the ball for our own good. We want to see how many players we can run over. And that causes that everybody is waiting for the next move. We're setting up play, we're waiting for the next move. While most other big teams nowadays, they try to penetrate and everybody runs off them and they run into spaces so that they can take the game at pace further. That is the one thing at this moment that we need to understand. The other thing that we need to understand is that some people are left brainers, others are right brainers, and those combinations are so important so that they can work as a pair, especially the two centers, the two locks, two flankers, those kind of people. They must work in pairs, and at this moment we lack that because we're queuing for everybody is waiting to carry the ball.
Coach, I know you're more comfortable talking about the game on the field, so we'll continue with that. You know, you spoke about how important it is for a player to be himself and to be able to just be creative on the field. We've discussed this a few times on the show, but Pat Lambie has seemed to not get a starting berth because he has to fit into that mould that Heineke Meyer wants. We know what a creative player he is and we know how he thinks about the game. We certainly want to see him start. Why is Hanre Pollard chosen as a first choice fly half over Pat Lambie?
Well, I can't answer that question for you, but what I can say to you, you are so right. Sometimes the intellectual levels of our players are much higher than what the coaches are. And the coaches can't handle it. So the coaches can't tell them why they did it. The players can give you a reason and not an excuse why they did it. And then they put the player, the coaches out of, and the coaches seems to be out of depth. There's a lot of those kind of players around us. I had a few, but I admitted it and I gave them the opportunity to be themselves, because if you love yourself and if you can understand where you're growing, where you're going, you can take a lot of people with you, you know. But if you don't, then you only do things to satisfy other people. Mm. And whenever you want other people to acknowledge how good you are, you will never know how good you really are because you don't believe that you're good.
Coach, if you were in that position, who has stood out for you in the past couple of seasons? Hanre Pollard did fantastic at the 2012 Junior World Cup, but Pat Lambie just has that other dynamic part to him.
Yeah, you know, there's a lot of things that I don't agree with, but I don't think it's my competency at this moment to tell what and what not. But because you know the game, everybody in Africa do know the game, we can see it. We have this kind of opinions that we all have, and it doesn't mean that you're wrong or somebody else is right. What we need to understand, and we need to understand it clearly, is the fact that if they're going to try to run the ball against Wales, a lot of players won't know where to run to. But if they're going to play that boring Channel 1 and Channel 2 ball in this game against Wales, everybody understand what they do, and they might just break down the confidence of Wales being in their faces all the time. So it might be the right thing to go back for this tournament, but what after this? And how many players? I mean, you've got Willy Leroux, you've got Brian Abana, I don't care who the other wing will be, you've got outside centre in Jesse Creel, you've got hookers who can run the ball, you've got such a lot of players with that creative minds, but it's been oppressed into a form that they listen, this is what we do, and that's the only thing we do. Because they understand it, we're not doing it bad. But if somebody else come and they break it down for us, then we're going to doubt, and when we start doubting, everybody's going to play whatever they do. We could see it against Samoa. We could see it in some of the games when we were out of a pattern because everybody wanted just to go impress the coach. And I think that is still on the cards.
Absolutely. Now, another combination, and I said we'd speak about this, is that lock, the lock combination, but also who the lock will be. You know, Victor Matfield played under you, and we know what a great man he is on the field and off the field. But Luat de Jager has just been a fantastic 50 tackles so far. You know, he's been more than just a lock on the field.
Yeah, you're right. You know, it comes back to combinations again. If you look what Victor can bring to this game, Victor will cause doubt in the minds of the opponents immediately when Heineke select him. So I think he can be a wonderful weapon for us to go onto the field with. If you think of putting him on the bench, it's the wrong thing because he will never be able to take the game to the next level. Mm. But what he can do, he can set a standard for the next guys who come on. The combination that will work the best, everybody think Itzebeth is a mini. Itzebeth is not a mini. Itzebeth is actually the same kind of player that Victor is. Mm. He's more skillful than the other players, and his work rate is not that high in the loose play. So I would go for Victor and for Luat as a starter, and then bring Itzebeth off the bench in the place of Victor if we need it. But Luat is the one guy who need to be there because Luat, Scott Berger, Bismarck Duplessis, they were the guys who allowed Fourie de Pree to play on the front foot. They actually caused the momentum for the team, and everybody else ran off them. It made Damien Delenda look 10 times better than what he is at the moment. So if you're gonna make the wrong decisions, and everything is gonna start by the selection of this team, and especially our bench, because our bench need to take us to a next level when they come on.
Well, certainly, and you mentioned Damien Delenda. How has he impressed you as a player?
Well, I think he's still a long way to go in my mind. He's not to me that conventional cutout 12 that we need, the guy that will take them on, take them off the field, and then create space for somebody else to run through and run into and make them doubt on the other side. He runs over the guys and then he dies with the ball most of the time. So he's setting up play brilliantly. But then after that, after a setup play, and what we must understand with our defensive patterns, as soon as you set up play, you set up defense too. So the more you set up, the more defense can set up too. And what defense are doing, they're slowing the ball down so that they can form a brilliant line against us. So the Channel 1, the big defenders are normally there, and that is where the Fourie de Pree, when they get it on the front foot, are so brilliant. He normally selects a channel where the guys can run into, and it's normally a channel where there's no numbers to stop us and the spaces are there. So yeah, we need the right selection, and the right selection will actually cause a lot of troubles for Wales.
Coach, just a last question. You know, we can't say that this is a walkover game. We saw what happened with Japan, but on paper we should win this one. And then we'll most likely face New Zealand in the semi and hopefully Australia in the final. We haven't been able to beat these two dominant teams in the Rugby Championship. How will we do this in the World Cup?
You know, your rugby intellect is so high, you know. You're so right. We first have to climb over this hurdle, and this is going to be a very tough hurdle. This is going to be our first tough game in a competition, but so for New Zealand too. The difference between us and New Zealand at this moment is we both play bad, bad rugby. But through all the bad rugby New Zealand are playing, they still have the abilities to put 20 and 40 points between them and their opponents. We can't do that, you know. The only time that we did it was against USA, but we should have never have lost against Japan. By losing against Japan, we just filled the cup for Wales so that they can go out and go win us. And they will throw us with a kitchen sink, I'm telling you now. This game will be win and lost by penalties. Discipline will be very, very important. Over the ball, off the ball, our running support lines will be very important to put them under pressure. If we can make this one, I think we stand a very, very good chance, because New Zealand at this stage is not on form either, and we can actually have a good game against them.
Coach, thank you very much for that insight on Game On, and we certainly hope to see you in charge of a club, if not in South Africa, and somewhere else around the world.
Thank you so much, eh? Thank you for having me.